Finn, Grave, Scrags, Moss, Moomin, Bridge, Frost, Darkspear, Bog, Bulgin, Internet? Wait, let's talk about trolls. Trolls come from a Scandinavian folklore as well as parts of Norse mythology. They range from varieties in sizes and shapes and cultures, some being very close to humans and other being large enough to create entire mountains out of hills as they turn to stone in the sunlight. Oh boy, that's a weird thing we're going to have to talk about. The only thing that seems to be consistent across the mythos is that trolls don't like living near humans, or at least they try to stay clear of them as much as possible. Regardless of whether they live individually or in small family groups, beyond that, they have such a wide range of potentials to look and act however you really want to make them. Take a look at the classic D&D trolls, and no, I'm not talking about gnome bards who name themselves Oh, I can't say that on YouTube. Weird. Alright, well, let's do wagons. Nope. Okay, great. Well, how about Johnny Big Johnson? Yeah, I guess I don't know why I thought that would be better. Anyways, trolls go all the way back to the first edition of D&D in 1974 and were notably rubbery and able to regenerate. And while rubbery probably sounds more like a slime than a giant, which trolls technically are, rubber giants, I still don't know why they have weird crystals in their tum-tums. That might be a different kind of troll. There isn't a lot to go on of why trolls would turn into stone in sunlight, except for some ancient anecdotal stories about Thor and dwarves, and Tolkien's old notes. Basically, I think it has something to do with them being from the earth and not liking the sun, but I'm just going to ignore that. I think the thing we want to focus on here is regeneration. As stated earlier, trolls are variable across the mythos, and the D&D universe is no different. While you can make a troll into pretty much any type of creature, from a giant bridge guardian that eats goats to a very small forest creature waiting to steal your unbaptized children and turn them into fey changelings, that might be another video. Key factor here that unifies them all across all of the fey wilds and the giant kin is their ability to regenerate. This, oddly enough, might be something that was propagated by Gygax himself. The stories that Gygax chose to base his stories on were kind of the only literature about trolls being able to regenerate, and they were also this kind of rubbery rendition of themselves. There is no real-world analog for trolls to do this, but it's now become part of the lexicon that trolls regenerate and are weak to fire. This bridges the gap from Magic the Gathering to World of Warcraft. I love it. There's even an episode of X-Men where they compare Wolverine's healing factor to that of a troll. Thank you, mid-90s cartoon crossovers. The point being that trolls are a rather vanilla monster. Being very large, having a keen sense of smell, they're just hella strong and hard to kill. That could describe any number of large, scary creatures in D&D, but their regeneration is enough to make them not only terrifying in a fight, but straight out being banned as a playable race by most D&D campaigns I've ever played in. There was one time. One time someone said, yeah, sure, why not? I'm still waiting to play that game. It's been 4 years, so let's talk about stats for a little bit and why regeneration is such a game-breaking ability. Trolls, being a super classic monster, have been statted quite a few times. In Pathfinder alone, they exist as 23 different iterations in the monster manuals, and that's not including third-party content. In most of those situations, their strength and constitution are through the roof. If you wanted to roll the stats like normal, I would definitely see something to the effect of +4 strength, +6 constitution, and -2 intelligence, wisdom, and charisma. That sounds really rough, but that really is the basic form of these primal brutes. From another perspective, I could make an argument that trolls basically don't have to roll for constitution and strength. They should just start maxed out in it, maybe at 18, and if they choose to take different feats or things to get it to 20, or maybe beyond that, I think that's totally legit. Mind you, this would be based around playing the troll as a large creature. If you wanted to make them medium or small or even tiny, because trolls can do that, I would definitely augment the strength down slightly to accommodate that. You can look at the Pathfinder charts to try to figure that out. If you want to go the other way and be huge or gargantuan, because why not? I think you should just go with the maxed out stat. As for strength, I really like the idea that trolls struggle to use normal weapons based on the fact that they tend to break things not knowing their own strength. That can include weapons or gear. This rejection of human tools and armor has some really fun potential in and out of combat. As for the -2 to all mental stats, following the same idea where you're the biggest, meanest, and most unkillable thing out there, you don't really spend much time trying to improve your mind and your social standing. There could be an argument against this if you go with the family based in troll villages. In that situation, I would ignore the negatives to wisdom and still focus on the int and charisma penalties. And while dexterity seems to be a high priority for a race that can't or chooses not to wear armor, not having that bonus to it may not matter in the long run. Trolls really don't care about getting hit, and that's kind of half the fun. As for the armor, trolls seem to have a proclivity for natural armor. Every version I've found has some type of toughness, whether it's from being based on their size or just having naturally tough skin. This mixed with their ability to regenerate, and almost every iteration of the monster manual showing them as these huge and bulking forms without armor or clothes, maybe that's why they're so terrifying. I mean, running around in the dark, flopping about, chasing people out of caves, that doesn't really sound fun at all. For the person being chased. It's probably why there's signs up in the villages. No floppy trolls. Put some damn pants on. Just saying. And I could definitely see that being part of the trade-off for regeneration. That is to say that trolls naturally don't wear armor or they lose their proficiency, not that they like to chase people flopping about. That could really mean so many different things. Gross. I totally get that if you really are just looking to be as OP as possible, a troll in plate mail would probably be the way to do it. I think them having the natural armor because of their reckless nature and their general toughness is a better route to go, and I think it could work very similarly to Barbarian's unarmored defense, which would be 10 plus your dexterity plus your constitution modifier, which if we're going with the natural 20 on constitution, then they start out with a flat 15 AC and you don't really have to worry about the dex bonus at all. This is one of those situations where this character has a very high potential for feeling broken, especially at level one. And that's why it's kind of fun to really focus on one thing and start removing normal aspects of the characters instead of trying to build a very, very broken OP character. In addition to all the stats, you do get keen smell. This is a monstrous feat. It isn't super useful in all situations, but I think it's a nice boon for passive perceptions and things like tracking and hunting, which trolls should be very good at, just naturally. Beyond that, they don't have much else going on for them besides the regeneration. If you keep the monster feats, which I've talked about before, where you just take some monster levels instead of rolling your stats, you can also gain access to multi-attack, or you could take that as a feat which would give you two claws and a bite attack, which is kind of a cool trade if you decide to go the no weapons route because you constantly break things. I love to see a troll with a greatsword, though, so that might be something I wouldn't do just so I could have a magical acid spewing greatsword and have fun with it. Tobias, the troll slaying troll, pact of the toll, pact of the soul, troll warlock. Where the hell am I even going with this? There are a few other variants that have things like bleed attacks or poisonous pustules that explode when you take damage. And those things are a little specific, but I mean, we're already so far off the map that maybe Johnny Big needs some acid blood. I could really take it or leave it. If that's what you want to do, I say go for it. And now onto the regeneration. And we should start by saying that the book states, because of their regenerative abilities, trolls are fearless. Even flames or the possession of acid don't slow them down. They always fight to the death. That, I think, is very indicative of trolls as a whole. It's not supposed to be about how tough you can make the troll, because the trolls just don't care. They don't need the armor. They don't care about the weapons. They just want to hunt, and they just want to eat. And that's hella dope. If you take a look around the boundless iterations of trolls over the years, their regenerative abilities are off the charts, maybe excluding the Moomin, which, to be fair, I've never seen a Moomin get hit with a battle axe, so maybe they do have the super healing factor. I don't know. For D&D, 10 regeneration, that's 10 healing every round, at the beginning of the round, which sounds impossible to handle as a DM. And that's pretty standard across most of Pathfinder, as well as D&D, ranging from 5 to 10. And on a monster, that's devastating, and most DMs don't want to deal with that level of silliness. Should we count regeneration as a type of sealant? Like blood sealant? Food for thought. In Pathfinder, a ring of regeneration, which gives you 1 HP per round, costs 90,000 gold. Just keep that in your brain for a little bit. That does also give you access to regrowing limbs, regrowing eyeballs, stopping permanent stat damage if you're doing that kind of thing in your game, which I don't highly suggest you do. Regrowing eyes, being immune from blindness over time. That's a hell of a lot of for Johnny Boy over there. Coolest part about regeneration is that it allows you to come back to life from individual cells. Wolverine style. So long as regeneration is active, at the start of your turn, you gain those hit points, and with the 5e death save system, it's going to make you almost unkillable, and that's really fun. It's also why trolls are so scary as a monster to fight, because if you don't know the trick behind it, they just keep coming back. Now, there are some different ways to look at this and to make it not seem so overly powerful. If you take fire or acid damage on your last turn, you don't heal, and that is from the book. That's how the regeneration works, and thus making fire and acid required to kill trolls. But herein lies the mean fixing the playable character. It's basically common knowledge because of how pervasive the trolls are in all of the monster manuals and across the different editions that I would say it is also common knowledge inside of the world of D&D. Aside from most town folks wanting to burn you on sight, there are a lot of creatures that have acid and fire damage. As for the homebrew, to make the game somewhat more interesting, I have some ideas on how to balance it. First, if you don't go with the maximum healing angle of the regen, you drop it down to your, say, your constitution modifier, it has the ability to change over time, and then you could just use the monster rules of it not functioning on a round when you take fire or acid damage. Second option, which I'm not a big fan of, is that you would only regenerate during short and long rests, and this ability basically just wouldn't worry about your hit dice, or you could double your hit dice, and I don't really like this one. I see this a lot of times as homebrew, and it just doesn't feel very troll-like to me. It makes the fire and acid angle less interesting and kind of pointless. The third option, which is my favorite, requires a bit more math, which maybe that's always why things are my favorite. Basically, you keep the 10 HP regeneration, but you build out a second pool of health to track that is specifically acid and fire damage. This damage does not regenerate until you take a long rest, and that makes fire and acid damage permanent until you have time to sit down and actually take the time to recuperate and regenerate. Another easy way to look at it is you can basically look at all damage that is not fire, and acid damage is basically non-lethal. That might be an easy way to track it on D&D Beyond, but the idea is that you can't heal back that damage until you take a long rest, and that makes it more of a gamification of the hit point system. We haven't even started talking about, you know, selling your troll blood and other floppy body parts to shady alchemists for a high price. Yeah, maybe we don't need to talk about that right now. Playing monstrous campaigns won't get much more epic and high fantasy than if you're trying to play as a troll. They should be famously terrifying to anyone you meet, and cities around should have signs posted about beware of trolls, just adding to the confusion and the terror. Plus, how often is a mob carrying torches going to be effective against your party? Like, this might be the one situation, unless you're playing vampires. That could be a different video, though. Troll vampire, holy crap. I hope you've become inspired to play a troll in the future campaign. They are so versatile, from adding tusks to horns to innate fairy magic. The possibilities really are endless with this bunch. There's literally decades of source material that you can pull from to create your own self-healing monstrosity. Thanks again for watching. Remember to comment, like, and subscribe. Feel free to share these videos with your friends. The artwork is available up on Patreon for anybody that wants to use it for their campaign. And as always, remember to keep your dice on the table. Johnny F-boy Doc. Johnny F-boy Donkey. No, I got this. Johnny F-boy Donkey. Wait, what? Donkey? That's not even a bad word. Now you're just f-ing. Okay, I see what you did there. Nice. No, that was f-ing. Okay, now you're just big. Got it. Okay, thanks.